Studios in Florida. Gene Siskel and Roger Ebert, if we pick the winners.
Thanks very much. Welcome to our annual special, If We Pick the Winners, our traditional fantasy in which Roger and I hold our version of the Oscars with only two people having ballots, and I'm one of them. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm the other one. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. Now, Gene and I do not, unfortunately, have a vote in the annual Academy Awards. But like a lot of people, we know how we would vote if we could vote, and that's what this annual special program is all about. Who we would mark our ballots for if we pick the Oscars. Now, I may be right, or for that matter, Gene may be wrong, but at least we don't keep you waiting for the most important categories. Gene's going to start right now with the nominees for Best Actress.
Yeah, usually on the Oscar show, you have to wait about 3 hours before you get to this category, so you're already ahead. Okay, the Best Actress nominees are... Catherine Deneuve, a wealthy French plantation owner caught in the changing fortunes of Southeast Asia in Indochine. McDonald, a soap opera actress embittered by an accident that has placed her in a wheelchair in Passion Fish.
And you can shoot a few angles of me in bed and I can come down here and phone in voiceover, Vance. Brain death. Think of the metaphoric possibilities in that.
I'd have to check with Edna.
You do that.
Michelle Pfeiffer, a Dallas housewife in the 60s, fixated on Jackie Kennedy in the drama Love Field.
I think that's how children handle things. They go inside. I love children. I lost a baby this summer, just like Jackie.
Susan Sarandon, an impassioned mother fighting to save her young son, dying from a seemingly incurable disease in Lorenzo's oil.
So what you're saying is that our children are in the service of medical science. How very foolish of me. I always assumed that medical science was in the service of the sufferers.
And Emma Thompson, the emancipated intellectual of Howard's End.
We're nearly demented. Mr. Wilcox, I am demented.
Here inside the sealed envelope is Roger's pick for Best Actress. This is not who he thinks is going to win. This is who he wants to have win. And I'm finding it out for the first time. Roger's pick for Best Actress is Emma Thompson in Howard's End.
Right? This was a very tough choice for me, Gene, and it finally came down to Mary McDonnell and Emma Thompson. Those were the two I had to choose from, and it's a shame to have to pick between two inspired performances like theirs. But I finally marked my ballot for Emma Thompson because she did something in Howard's End that is very hard for an actress to do. She projected backbone and determination in a quiet, understated way.
Will you forgive her? As you yourself have been forgiven.
Look at her here in this crucial scene with Anthony Hopkins. He plays a banker whose first wife admired the intelligence and determination of the young woman. Now Thompson has become the man's second wife and has just learned of an affair he had years ago, but she isn't mad at him for his immorality. She's mad at him for being a hypocrite and not holding himself to the same high standards he so arrogantly holds for others.
You have had...
Emma Thompson is a wonderful actress. She can play broad comedy, like in the movie The Tall Guy, and melodrama, like in Dead Again. And here she takes a subtle character and makes her unforgettable. So she's my choice in this
category. All right, well, look at my choice.
Okay, I have Gene's ballot right here, sealed away. And you have extremely good taste, Mr. Siskel, because you would also select Emma Thompson for Howard's End.
My selection is Emma Thompson for Howard's End, and I'm picking Thompson because of the subtlety of her character and performance, is what I think what you were saying, Roger. She plays a complex woman, and Thompson, as an actress, doesn't push her into caricature.
It's heartbreaking to leave one's old home.
Here's a marvelous scene with Emma Thompson showing the subtlety of her character and also the unpredictability of her performance. She's about to be proposed marriage by the older, much wealthier Anthony Hopkins. She knows it even before he speaks a word, and I like the way she cuts him off. Then silently, watch how she registers delight and fear. She's ambivalent about this marriage, as well she should be, and it's all on the screen in these precious few silent seconds.
Do you think you could...
We have seen countless wedding proposals in the movies, and the stereotype is someone's always surprised. Well, it's rarely true in real life. People know when it's coming, and we see it in that scene. It's a beautifully acted scene. Right under Emma Thompson's skin, we can see an original character, someone straining to do and say the right thing, someone who's freer with ideas than with emotion, someone who's very good and yet trapped in her English way by her economic class. And this character is so complicated that one can debate the final relationship she has with Anthony Hopkins in the picture. Is it accommodation? Is it pity, love, or love of property? And the only reason we can have that debate is that Thompson's character is as complex as a real human being. I'm really glad
you picked
her.
I agree with you, Gene. I agree. And you know what she is in this film? This film is filled with a lot of colorful people. The Anthony
yes.
Hopkins character, her sister, played by Helena Bonham Carter.
Right.
She is, Emma Thompson, the still, calm
yes.
center of the film. She doesn't have a lot of the flashy scenes.
Right.
But the whole movie is about her, and she has to project it almost in terms of inner character in many places.
Yes, but the storyteller, the central figure, is usually
yeah.
the most boring in a movie, and yet look at how we can differentiate in that character and all about her. This is most unusual work by her.
Well, she's very good, and so we obviously both hope that she wins. Okay, onward to the next category, which is Best Supporting Actor, and the nominees are...
You're gonna tell me what's wrong.
No, not here.
Jaye Davidson is a London hairdresser whose lover was kidnapped by the Irish Republican Army in The Crying Game.
Shouldn't I go?
Yes.
Gene Hackman as a sadistic sheriff who runs a tight little town in Unforgiven.
What's this for, snakes and such? Yeah. We don't have any snakes in here, Mr. Hendershot.
Jack Nicholson as a Marine commander whose temper explodes in A Few Good Men.
I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Al Pacino as a desperate real estate salesman in Glengarry Glen Ross.
I gotta argue with you. I gotta knock heads with the cops. I'm busting my balls, sell your dirt to deadbeats. Money in the mattress. I come back, you can't even keep the contract safe.
And David Paymer as the long-suffering brother and manager of a stand-up comic in Mr. Saturday Night.
With 36.
36, that's good. From 3 to 36, that's a good thing.
It's just temporary. You got Davy Crockett against you for a few weeks. It's a fad. It'll go away.
Now, those are the nominees for Best Supporting Actor. Let me open up Gene's vote and see who you would vote for if you picked the Oscars. If you did, it would go to Jaye Davidson in The Crying Game.
Absolutely. Okay, a tricky situation this year. Let me talk directly now to the audience watching this show. There's a secret in The Crying Game. You probably heard about it. And if you plan on seeing it and haven't yet, you might want to turn down the audio on your set.
Oh, you're not going to do that now, because nobody's going to turn down their audio.
You've been warned now, so no angry calls. My choice is Jaye Davidson. I recently saw The Crying Game for the second time, and I was able to focus on Jaye Davidson, a male actor playing a man who dresses and behaves like a woman. And there's a real performance up there on the screen. This is not a freak show or a drag routine. Jaye Davidson gives us a very particular character, a vulnerable guy who makes his way through the world as a woman.
See that car?
See what, Bill?
He gave me a look.
Did he?
Just cut his hair, you know.
Yeah?
So what do you think?
Nice.
Did it again.
I saw that one.
And what would you call that?
That was a look.
What do you think his name might
be? I have no thoughts on the subject.
Jimmy. Jimmy?
Jimmy, that's what he said.
Hi, Jimmy.
Now think about what this actor had to do. Appear convincing as a woman, even close-ups on a big screen, and also play a character who is known as a transvestite in a regular bar, and then in comes this guy who may know what's going on or maybe not, and when she realizes he doesn't know her identity, well, then She's very gentle, and yet later in the film, she's going to be called upon to be very tough. I think it's easily the most difficult performance of the year. Whether it's a supporting performance is debatable. I think it's a starring performance, actually. Could it have been done better, however, or as well? And if so, by whom? And Roger, if you disagree with me on this one, I'm going to be very upset. I think it's a spectacular performance.
Well, first of all, I don't think you should have given The Secret away, because very few people have actually seen this film in terms of a national television audience. I think it was cheating, because to me, one of the real pleasures of watching this film was to walk in there and not know until a crucial moment in the film what The Secret was. I don't know if people turned down their sets in time, and I think it was, you were, in order to make your opinion, what you were doing was you were keeping them from enjoying what I think and what I agree with you is a great performance.
Well, the question would be, how can I do criticism of this work without talking about why I think it's so much of a stronger performance? And unfortunately, what we're going to end up debating now is whether I should have given The Secret away as opposed to whether or not how...
Oh, it's a very good performance. Yeah, it is a good performance.
Well, let's see if you picked it as the best.
Why don't you see if I picked it or not?
I hope you do. Mm-hmm. You pick, instead, Al Pacino in Glengarry Glen Ross.
That's right. And from what I've heard, Al Pacino might be the front runner in a different category. When the real Oscars are given out, I think he may win for Best Actor for Sin of a Woman. But I actually think he did his best work this year in Glengarry Glen Ross, and for that matter, so did a lot of other people. You could almost have nominated any member of the cast of that film in this category and not made a mistake, Jack Lemmon in particular. But look at the way Pacino thinks on his feet in this scene, where Jonathan Pryce is a reluctant property buyer and fellow salesman Jack Lemmon helps Pacino by posing as a long-term customer.
Ray is with American Express. Can I tell Jim what you do?
Sure.
Ray is director of all European sales and services for America. What I'm saying is, you haven't had a meal until you tasted it. I was at the Links. What was that service feature you were talking about?
You wish?
Home cooking. What did... You had a tag phrase that you used?
Cooking.
Home the monthly interview.
The magazine.
Yes.
Oh, well...
Is that something I can talk about?
Well, it won't be out until the February issue, but I'll go ahead.
Are you sure?
Go ahead.
Anyway, Ray was eating one of his company men's homes in France, right? The man is French.
You know, but his wife is.
Oh, his wife. Ray, what time do you have?
He's very good there, the way he's feeding those lines to Lemon, and Lemon is picking up on them. What's interesting there is that the acting is on two levels. These are actors playing salesmen who are acting out an improvised scenario. Glengarry Glen Ross is an actor's play filled with colorful speeches and big moments, but it's also a playwright's piece, and David Mamet's dialogue seems simple, but it's very hard to get right, and Pacino, I think, gets it exactly right, so that's who I would pick in this category.
But, Roger, there are a half dozen to maybe two dozen actors who could do the role as well.
Oh, I'm not at all sure that's the case.
Well, I'll tell you actually saw one. We both saw one in Chicago, and his name is Joe Mantegna. And I don't think you're going to tell me he did it on stage, and you're not going to, he won a Tony Award for it, and you're not going to tell me that Pacino did it any better.
Gene, what I'm doing here is I'm selecting the best performance out of the five nominees,
right,
as everybody else has to do, because we might even have different people we'd want in this category.
No, what I'm saying,
I think of the five nominees, Pacino is certainly the strongest.
I'm telling you that Alec Baldwin, who also appeared in this film, could have done the role just as
well
as opposed.
To repeat again, you know, John Barrymore could have done a good job, too, and it's too bad Laurence Olivier isn't around. But among the people who were nominated, the best performance was by Al Pacino.
But I got news for you. Lionel Barrymore or John Barrymore or Ethel Barrymore couldn't have done the role of Jaye Davidson as well as Jaye Davidson did the role. Coming up next, our choice is another big category, Best Actor.
I think Clint. Clint's a nice guy. And I think he's made a lot of friends in Hollywood.
Jumping jellyfish, it's Ariel!
The Little Mermaid is back with three brand new videos in sparkling new glitter boxes. There are exciting new stories to watch with Ariel and all of her friends.
Hey, that's me!
And wonderful new songs to sing.
Look, man, I'm jumping!
Make Ariel a part of your child's world when you buy Ariel's Undersea Adventures on video. And now you can get Ariel's treasure case free with the purchase of two Ariel videos.
Sunspot by Sunchips.
Spot!
Sunchips multi-grain snacks. There's nothing quite like that delicious sun-drenched taste.
Oh,
sunscreen by SunChips. One bite and you'll know why a little sun never tasted so good.
Flying coach was a bit of a drag, but I'm here.
Jane, I'd like you to meet Peter. Peter makes movies.
Features.
Hi, we were just talking about this movie that HBO made. It was so intense. Did what? You make that movie?
No, I didn't.
Oh, you didn't make that.
I'm at home thinking they'll never show.
And then they show.
Were you talking about that HBO movie?
You're really gutsy, huh?
I didn't even know they made movies.
Did you make that?
No, I didn't.
Oh,
you didn't? I read that movie, caused a lot of controversy. But you probably stay away from stuff like that, huh? Too risky, huh?
Movies that get people talking. Movies that matter. HBO makes them, and you don't want to miss them.
It was edgy.
Poignant.
No, I didn't make it.
Excuse me. I heard you make movies for HBO?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Think you've seen great movies before? Just you wait.
You know, people have been talking about my movies all night.
Welcome back. Welcome back to the annual Siskel and Ebert special. If we pick the winners, this is the show where we tell you who we'd vote for if we could vote for the Academy Awards. And the next category is one of the big ones for the year's best performance by an actor. The nominees are Robert Downey Jr. playing the great silent comedian in Chaplin. Clint Eastwood is a professional killer who comes out of retirement in Unforgiven.
It's a hell of a thing, killing a man. You take away all he's got, and all he's ever gonna have.
Al Pacino as a blind retired army officer who gives a kid some free advice in Scent of a Woman.
About your little problem. There are two kinds of people in this world. Those who stand up and face the music, and those who run for cover. Cover is better.
Stephen Ray is an IRA fighter who tries to escape from his past in The Crying Game.
When I was a child, yeah. When I became a man, I put away childish things.
And Denzel Washington as the charismatic black rights leader in Malcolm X.
Before there was any such thing as a Jew or a Christian, we were black people. In fact, before there was any such place as America, we were black.
Right. Okay. Those are the nominees, and I have in this sealed envelope Gene's choice for best actor, and you would vote for Denzel Washington.
I pick Denzel Washington in a close nod over Stephen Ray and Robert Downey Jr. That's because Denzel Washington had the biggest challenge of the year, playing four ages of Malcolm, from hustler to convict to student to leader.
Evidently, the some type of bomb, Molotov cocktail bomb, was thrown against the back of the house. One was thrown on the side of the house, from what I could tell. It bounced up against the window, and that's what woke my daughter up. And had it gone inside the window, my 2-year-old, my 4-year-old, and my 6-year-old daughter would have been... I'm just telling you, had that happened, I'd have taken my rifle, I'd have gone after anyone in sight.
Do you think this was a warning or an attempt on your life?
What does it look like? Does it look like a warning to you?
We have plenty of news footage of the real Malcolm X, of course, on tape. And when that video was shown at the end of the movie, I didn't see any appreciable difference between the real man and Denzel Washington's performance. He hit every note, didn't stumble once. I didn't see Denzel Washington repeating himself from other movies. I bought the whole thing. It's a great, great piece of work. And now?
Why don't you go ahead and open my envelope, Gene?
Well, that means only one thing to me.
It does, only one thing, that's right.
Denzel Washington and Malcolm X.
That's right. This was really one of my easiest choices this year because Denzel Washington's performance has so much range and power. He betrays Malcolm X from his earliest days on the street to his final days as an internationally known African-American spokesman, and there's hardly a note from greed to rage to love to political and personal conversion that he doesn't get just right.
The hardest and the greatest.
Here he is midway in the film, a street kid who has been sent to prison and is recruited there by the black Muslims.
I don't know what I would say to Allah. Have you ever bent your knees, Malcolm? Yes, when I was picking a lock to rob someone's house.
Tell Allah that.
And here he is much later in the film on a TV talk show, expressing opinions that TV viewers were startled to hear said out loud in the early 1960s.
Well, for the white man to ask the black man why he hates him is like the wolf asking the sheep or the rapist asking the rape, do you hate me? The white man is in no moral position to accuse the black man of anything.
You know, in a way, the lead in Malcolm X is not one role, but many roles, just as Malcolm was many men. In a lot of movie biographies, the hero seemed to have been heroic right from the start, but Washington shows us the agonizing process by which Malcolm Little became Detroit Red and then Malcolm X. He's recruited by the black Muslims in prison. He educates himself by reading the dictionary. He turns from a criminal into a leader of men. And there is not a step in that journey that Denzel Washington doesn't make completely convincing. We apparently both agree it's the performance of the year.
Well, I'll tell you, the thing that I like about it is that sometimes in biographies you can tell early on in the scene that they know they're going to be great and special. Mm-hmm. The movie gives it away, and so does the actor in some sense, being a little more in control of himself.
Yes.
Here we don't get that. There's discovery at every change, and that is a tribute to a really immaculate performance by Denzel Washington.
Well, I certainly hope that the Academy agrees with us. And when we come back, the people who shoot the movies, a new category, the best cinematography.
Denzel Washington. I hope he gets it. I think he did a really, really fine acting job. It was really weird. He was like in a zone.
Now we introduce a new category in our annual special, Best Cinematography. The cinematographer is responsible for the lighting and photography in a movie, and he's often the reason some movies look like miracles and other movies look like mud. Using visuals, he can also create or underline the mood of a picture, and the nominees are Stephen H. Burham for Hoffa.
In every conflict there, Cash, the question is, what has been lost and what has been gained?
Yeah, but what about
make the rest of it up yourself?
Tony Pierce Roberts for Howard's End. Robert Fress for The Lover.
You should know what it is. A love like this. So strong that it'll never happen again in a lifetime.
Philippe Rousselot for A River Runs Through It.
See you later, boy!
And Jack N. Green for Unforgiven.
Get behind them rocks, David boy!
Get over there, Davey!
What happened? He ain't killed?
He gets in those rocks, we ain't gonna get him. Unless we go down there.
Gene's choice would be Jack N. Green for Unforgiven.
Right. First off, I ought to say that all of those are good nominations. American movies are looking better than ever, while the quality of the screenwriting and the imagination of the projects is in decline. My choice for Best Cinematography is Unforgiven by Jack N. Green, and maybe I'm selecting it because most of the other nominated pictures are full of pretty shots of beautiful things and locations, and by comparison, making a dark and brutally violent Western look arresting seems like a tougher chore. This film easily could have been muddy, same word that Roger used, but Jack Green keeps things sharp while maintaining an 1880s feel. I once had an Oscar-winning director tell me that it was easier to photograph mountains than the human face, and just look at the way that Jack N. Green photographs Clint Eastwood's face in profile in this beautiful scene from Unforgiven.
Cut up her face, cut her eyes out, cut her ears off, hell, even cut her...
Jesus.
$1,000 reward, Will. $500 apiece.
Paul? I can't move those damn pigs.
I did not vote thumbs up for Unforgiven on our show, and I saw it again recently, and my thumb is still down overall. But Jack Green's cinematography is, I think, the very best part of this film.
It's very, very good. And, you know, often in his westerns, Eastwood does shoot himself in a doorway. In that particular scene, it seemed to me there was even an echo of John Ford's The Searchers, where he has John Wayne frequently, the same way, because you see the indoors and the outdoors, and that's the conflict in the West. Okay. Let's look and see who I voted for.
Philippe Rousselot for A River Runs Through It. A beautiful film.
That's right. And I picked Rousselot for A River Runs Through It because I thought his work illustrated one of the key goals of cinematography, and that is to suggest what cannot be said.
Ten.
To him, all good things, trout as well as eternal salvation, come by grace.
This is a movie about two brothers, one destined to die young, the other destined to live a long time and write down their story. You know that when you read Norman MacLean's novel, but the movie cannot know that. The brothers live heedlessly in the present, not suspecting their fates, and so it is in the look of the picture, as much as anything else, that the underlying sadness can be established.
Catching it.
There is a way you can tell in that scene that it's being remembered many years afterwards, and not just because of the narration, but also because of the way it looks. The movie's whole bittersweet, nostalgic tone is largely, I think, because of the cinematography.
Well, it is a beautiful-looking movie, and I think I told you the basis on which I picked my preference, just that I felt that photographing beautiful things as the river locations in River Runs Through It, I think, is a little bit easier to do than interior work.
Well, but I mean, there are a lot of exteriors in Unforgiven, too, yeah. A lot of beautiful things. The mountains, the valleys, there are probably more exteriors, so your point doesn't hold up.
No, I think what I'm talking about is that I voted for it because of the interior work in Unforgiven.
I also like the interior work in River Runs Through It very much.
Which scene in particular are you thinking of in this moment?
Well, for example, the scene where the boys come in with their work to show their father in his study, and he says, now make it half as long.
Okay.
That was a good scene. When we come back, our picks for Best Supporting Actress.
Marissa Tomei for My Cousin Vinny. That's my personal pick.
The things we do to control what we eat.
Now you can give in to your craving for snacks the smart way. Introducing Orville Redenbacher Smart Pop. Compared to potato chips, new Smart Pop has 80% less fat and a third fewer calories, so you can eat and eat and eat and not feel the least bit guilty. New Smart Pop. From Orville Redenbacher, of course.
Of course.
Walt Disney World invites you to be our guest. Call 407-W-DISNEY.
Because no other pain is like your headache pain.
What the hell, Perry?
Now there's new aspirin-free Bayer Select for headaches. It contains two powerful aspirin-free ingredients and helps relieve pounding headache pain.
What the hell?
Oh, no. Looks like last week's pizza party dropped in our carpet.
That's okay.
That's okay? The stain's old.
I know.
She uses Resolve Carpet Cleaner with DuPont Teflon. With Resolve, even old stains come out with ease.
Uh-oh.
Get Resolve, also in refill.
That's okay.
Lysol spray use number 148. Those scuzzed out tennis shoes. Use number 56. That grungy stuff on the shower curtain. Use number 87, that nasty diaper pail with a goofy bunny. Lysol disinfectant spray. There's nothing this can can't do.
Welcome back to If We Pick the Winners, and our next category is Best Supporting Actress, and only one American actress is in the mix. The nominees are...
And he was quoting Yeats poems, and he was crying.
He was.
Yes,
Judy Davis, a frazzled New York woman in Husbands and Wives. Joan Plowright, an English lady, a widow on vacation in Italy in Enchanted April.
I need a room to myself. I'm an old woman. I can't get about because of my stick.
Vanessa Redgrave, an English lady, worried about the future of England in Howard's End.
If we could bring the mothers of the various nations together, then there would be no more war.
Miranda Richardson, another English lady whose husband is cheating on her with their son's girlfriend in Damage.
I don't trust her.
And Marissa Tomei is a spunky New Yorker stuck in the South with her lawyer boyfriend in My Cousin Vinny.
So you think you know what you're doing?
Yeah, I think I know what I'm doing.
because you didn't look like you knew what you were doing today in that courtroom. Why is that?
Okay, now Roger's choice for Best Supporting Actress. This is who Roger would like to see win in this category, and he picks Judy Davis in Husbands and Wives.
That's right. Judy Davis has been doing great work in the movies for several years now in films like My Brilliant Career, A Passage to India, and Barton Fink, but her work in Woody Allen's Husbands and Wives shows her at the top of her form. She and Sidney Pollack play a long married couple who decide to get divorced, shocking their friends, played here by Allen and Mia Farrow. One of the things that has always appealed to me about Judy Davis is a certain brittle intelligence that she brings to certain roles. You don't have the feeling she's reading dialogue. You feel like you're watching her think on her feet. And it's not often you see a supporting performance that shows the whole emotional arc of a character, but you see one here from Judy Davis.
I think intelligence is the key to this performance, and why don't you check out that envelope in your pocket?
Oh, does that mean only one thing, or does it mean two things?
Well, I think it only means one.
Only means one thing. It means that Gene selects Judy Davis for Husbands and Wives.
Yeah. I'm picking Judy Davis from Husbands and Wives in a close call over Vanessa Redgrave and Howard Zinn, and this is a shockingly fresh character. I mean, when I saw Husbands and Wives, naturally I expected to be preoccupied with studying Mia Farrow and Woody Allen, partially in a gossipy way, seeing if I could see any strain in their performances from any real-life problems creeping in. But right away, my attention was diverted by Judy Davis as their bright, neurotic, divorcing friend. Here she is resisting the advances of new boyfriend Liam Neeson. I always complain that movie characters are not as smart as the dumbest people I know. Well, Judy Davis's character is very smart and real, and her problems made me sad at times. And this is balanced with humor, balanced, but not overwhelmed, into someone who is cute and fuzzy. She's an original character, and Davis definitely deserves the Oscar.
You know, I agree. You know, just looking at that scene that we just saw, Gene.
That's a great scene.
Neeson is good in that scene, too. And as she's getting kissed, she kind of directs it. He doesn't know this. She puts her hand up like this, and at a certain point, she just says, cut. And then she pulls away and says, I can't go quite so fast.
I don't want to get involved.
That kind of body language is very good. It's a real good performance.
You bet.
Right. When we come back, the year's best original song.
Well, I think there's a lot of performances that stand out, but that's a no-win decision. You can't make that response very hard this time.
Okay, now a segment of our show that's more entertaining than the actual Oscar telecast. Of course, is there a part of our show that isn't more entertaining than the Oscar telecast? It's Best Song, because we bypass the bloated production numbers. Roger and I are not going to sing for you. We're not going to put on hats and feathers. We're going to focus on the music as presented in the movies. And the five nominees for Best Song are... Beautiful Maria of My Soul from the Mambo Kings. The music's by Robert Kraft, the lyrics by Arnie Glimcher.
Beautiful Maria of My Soul.
Friend Like Me from Aladdin. The music by Alan Menken, lyrics by the late Howard Ashman. I Have Nothing from The Bodyguard. Music by David Foster, lyrics by Linda Thompson. Run to You, music by Judd Friedman, lyrics by Alan Rich. And A Whole New World from Aladdin, music by Alan Menken, lyrics by Tim Rice. Hey, Roger, you picked Beautiful Maria of My Soul from the Mambo Kings.
That's right, yes. My choice is Beautiful Maria of My Soul for one very good reason, which is that I've been humming and singing that song at various times for a whole year since I first saw the movie.
I never love again. Even then, nothing will change, and the taste of you remains, clinging to paradise.
It's unabashedly romantic, it's cornball, it's over the top, and it perfectly captures the fiery passion of the love affair in the Mambo Kings. You know, Gene, they used to talk about songs that when you walked out humming the song.
Yeah.
This is one of the few songs in a long time that I've walked out humming and singing, and I enjoyed it.
No, it's a beautiful song. Take a look at my...
Does that selection mean only one thing?
Maybe, maybe not.
Oh, maybe not, probably. Let's see here. Gene would vote for Beautiful Maria of My Soul.
There you go.
From the Mambo Kings.
Let me tell you something. I never thought that you would pick this. I underestimate you quite often.
Frequently, yeah.
And with good reason, but not
thank
this
you.
Time. My choice is Beautiful Maria, My Soul, over The Clever Friend Like Me from Aladdin. And this was an easy pick because here is a rarity, a song that holds the entire key to the movie.
Of my soul.
The Mambo Kings is largely about this song and how it came to be written by a Cuban songwriter played by Antonio Banderas, who comes to America but still longs for the woman and the country he left behind. His songwriting partner is his brother, played by Armand Asante.
Filling all my nights, haunting all my days, beautiful Maria of my soul.
Rarely has a song so embodied the essence of a movie. Rent the Mambo Kings, and I think you're going to see and hear what I mean. Also, you'll see a very good love story.
That's for sure. In fact, yeah. I think that movie really got
bypassed
at the box office, deserved to be seen by more people than it did. Coming up next, the big one, our choices for the best picture of the year.
I think, remember you've heard it here first, I think Scent of a Woman is going to take it.
Later in the program will be our favorite category, the year's worst nomination. But before we get to that, maybe we better get to the most important category, which is the year's best picture. So if we could have a drum roll, please. The nominees are...
No way, Jude. I'm out.
You're never out, Fergus.
The Crying Game.
Maybe you don't care about yourself. Consider the girl, Fergus. The wee black chick?
Leave her out of this.
Jesus, Fergus, you're walking cliche. You know we won't leave her out of it.
A Few Good Men.
You want to investigate me, roll the dice and take your chances. I eat breakfast 300 yards from 4,000 Cubans who are trained to kill me, so don't think for one second that you can come down here, flash a badge, and make me nervous.
Howard's End.
The question to my mind is connected to something far greater. The rights of property itself.
Absolutely.
The house is mine and will one day be yours, Charles. When I say that I don't want anyone living at Howard's End, I mean that no one is to live at Howard's End.
Scent of a Woman?
There was a time I could see, and I have seen, boys like these, younger than these, their arms torn out, their legs ripped off. But there isn't. Nothing like the sight of an amputated spirit. There is no prosthetic for that.
And Unforgiven.
I've killed women and children. Killed just about everything that walks or crawls at one time or another. And I'm here to kill you, little Bill, for what you did to Ned.
Okay, those are the five nominees for the year's best picture, and in this sealed envelope is Gene's vote, and he would select... Howard's End.
That's right. This was my toughest choice to make, I think. I had placed Howard's End third and The Crying Game fourth on my list of the top 10 films of 1992, and that difference is very slight, to be sure. I saw both of these films again recently, and I'm staying with Howard's End, but it hurts me not to choose The Crying Game, a film I admire so much. Howard's End does incredible things, transferring a complex novel by Ian Forster to the screen while giving plenty of space to big ideas and both big and small characters.
Howard's End was almost pulled down once. It would have killed me. It's my house, you know. It was left to me by my brother who died out in India.
My favorite moment, which encapsulates the whole film, occurs in an early conversation between two women, played by Vanessa Redgrave and Emma Thompson, who barely know each other. But instinctively, they respect each other's decency. Here, Redgrave talks about her family summer home called Howard's End. And she might as well be talking about an England that once was and may never be again.
To the west of the house, just beyond the chestnut tree, in the paddock where the pony used to be.
Where's the pony gone?
Pony, oh, Dad, ever so long ago.
That's a lovely scene. In selecting Best Picture, I'm looking for a film that does try for greatness, and Howard's End could have been just another polite costume drama, but instead, these are urgent lives being played out in a variety of locales. I met a half dozen characters I won't forget. I remember the drawing rooms and the gardens and the city streets in which I met them. I'm thinking right now of the rainstorm in that film and how that plays such a critical role in the film. Director James Ivory and his producer Ismail Merchant and writer Ruth Prior-Javala have created a whole world on film. That's why Howard's End is my choice as best picture of the year.
Well, I think if you open the envelope, Gene, you'll find I have...
Okay. Well, hey, we agreed a lot this
year. Agreed
with
you on this one, yes.
Howard's End.
Howard's
Good.
End, yes, that's right. Yeah. The novel Howard's End by E.M. Forster is one of my favorite books. I've read it. I read it again recently. And I think it's amazing what a good job James Ivory and his collaborators did in this film in capturing the book's subtle and very complex spirit. This is a book about hypocrisy, about people who say one thing in public but do another thing in private. And look carefully at this scene and you'll see that process while it's at work. Anthony Hopkins plays a wealthy banker whose wife has just died, unexpectedly leaving her country home to a young woman who is not even related to the family. Well, of course, they will not even dream of respecting her dying wishes, but look how they talk about their dishonesty here, making it seem almost right. And that, of course, is last year's Oscar winner Anthony Hopkins there. Howard's End contains one brilliant thing after another. The screenplay by Ruth Prior-Javala makes everything clear and nothing obvious. James Ivory's direction is calm and perceptive. The photography somehow lets us know why the house named Howard's End is not just real estate, but the embodiment of a way of looking at the world. It's rare that I can say this about a movie, but watching Howard's End is a civilizing experience.
Well, it's educational in this sense, or at least it was for me. Frequently, from now on, when I look at a piece of property or a house on a piece of property, I will know that there will be stories generationally told of how this property came to be occupied by the people that are in it, how it was built, and what kind of travail may have gone on from one generation to another. It makes a home into a living character.
Yes, it does.
And it's a very special achievement.
It's a wonderful film. Coming up next, something exclusive to our award show. Gene and I choose the worst nominations of the year.
Okay, here's something you won't see anywhere else. Our choices of the worst nomination made by the Academy this year and the least deserving nomination of the year, according to Roger, is A Few Good Men as Best Picture nominee. You don't think it deserves it at all?
I do not. No, and it should not surprise you, Gene, that I picked A Few Good Men as my worst nomination of the year because of the five movies nominated for Best Picture, it was the only one that I originally voted thumbs down on. A Best Picture nomination is a precious thing. There are only five of them, and I was disappointed that the Academy membership wasted one on a movie that was not original or daring or especially brilliant. In a year that gave us Malcolm X, they must have been half asleep when they nominated a retread formula film like A Few Good Men.
Well, Roger, I agree with you. It did not deserve to be in the top five nominees. I mean, what about Malcolm X? What about The Player? What about One False Move, a movie, a small little movie, a great rental idea for people? No, you're quite right.
Okay, well, let's see who you picked.
I found something else that bothered
me. Worst nomination.
Okay.
See if I agree with you. Ooh, Michelle Pfeiffer is Best Actress for Love Field. You think is a bad nomination?
Yeah, I think Michelle Pfeiffer in Love Field, I thought her southern accent was much too broad. Let's listen to it for a bit.
What I want, Mr. Peter, is to go to my president's funeral. What I want is to go to that rotunda and file past that caisson or coffin or whatever it is and pay my respects.
It's more than just the accent. That caisson or coffin line didn't work. She didn't convince me that her character could be that dumb to get in the situation she did. In other words, I'm not talking about the dumb way her character was written. I'm talking about the way Pfeiffer couldn't hide her own intelligence from me on screen. She did a better job playing a working-class waitress in Frankie and Johnny a couple of years ago in Love Field. All I saw was her pretending to be a slightly dim Southern Belle. I see a lot of big-time actresses playing Southern women and playing them down as sort of dingbats.
Well, I think you have to give Michelle Pfeiffer credit at least for trying a lot of different kinds of roles, but I don't think this one deserved an Academy nomination. Okay, those are our worst nominations. And now, Gene, we always end the show this way. Imagine you're watching the Oscars.
Right, we will be.
Who, if they won, would give you the most personal pleasure? Which one would you cheer for?
The one I'd yell for would be Jaye Davidson, Best Supporting Actor for The Crying Game. I'm really rooting for that.
I would be very pleased to see Denzel Washington,
yes,
especially because not only is he great, Not only is he great, but the film is great too. And in a way, Denzel is carrying the banner for that entire film.
Absolutely, and I'm be rooting for that too. Well, that's it for this year's edition. If we pick the winners, the Academy will pick the real winners on Oscar night, March 29th. And until then, the envelopes are sealed.
The cast of the show joined many other stars in staying in the heart of the Epcot Resort area, the Walt Disney World Dolphin, where every minute is magic. It's America's favorite jelly beans, Jelly Belly, now appearing in theaters and video stores with good taste. Jelly Belly beans, try them, you'll love them. Load Hugger cargo nets expand to hold groceries, tools, sporting, and camping gear securely in place and are easy to install. No tools required. Load Hugger cargo nets. Sundance made with pure fruit juice and sparkling water, no sugar added, and that makes Sundance a natural refreshment for the whole family. From Cherokee, apparel, shoes, and accessories for men, women, and children, when you're comfortable, you can really go places. Make yourself comfortable, furnished by Cherokee.